So we've seen how to encrypt classical bits. But you might be wondering, can we also encrypt qubits? The answer to this is yes. To see this, let's first see what a quantum encryption scheme should actually look like. Alice's goal is now to send a qubit, Psi, to Bob. And she wants that Eve, who's trying to listen in to the wire, cannot learn anything at all about Psi. As before, we will allow Alice and Bob a key. This remains a classical key, a bit string. We will again need an encryption procedure. It takes Alice's qubit Psi and performs an operation on Psi that depends on the key. Alice sends the result to Eve, who we will again assume knows nothing about the key. Eve thus sees some state rho going across. Bob needs a decryption function, some other transformation that he can apply depending on the key, such that he ends up with Psi at the end. This should work for any state Psi, even if Alice does not know herself what Psi actually is. In other words, she has no classical description of what the amplitudes alpha and beta are, she just has one qubit, a preparation of a qubit. To summarize, also when encrypting qubits, we want that the scheme is correct. Bob can recover the qubit. And it is secure, meaning that the state rho that Eve sees is independent of Psi. Similarly to the classical one-time path, we will now construct a quantum one-time path. Let's briefly recapitulate what the classical one-time path is, but this time using quantum notation. For simplicity, we will just encrypt one classical bit, or later one qubit. But it works all the same if you consider many of them. Remember that to encrypt the classical message bit M, Alice XORed it with her key bit K. That gives her one bit E of encrypted text. Now remember that we can write a classical bit M in terms of the standard basis as a quantum state, namely ket M. Now computing the XOR is the same as applying a bit flip operation if k is 1 and doing nothing when k is 0. Remember that x is the quantum operation that does the bit flip. It takes m to m plus 1. Using the quantum notation, we can write that the classical one-time path, the encrypted bit, is equal to x to the power k applied to the message. So if the key is 1, we apply x. If the key is 0, we do nothing. Similarly, Bob can decrypt by just applying x to the power k again. Let's see what this looks like in terms of density matrices. You might think that we are making our lives artificially complicated, but using this density matrix formalism, it will actually be much easier to see that the classical one-time path is secure, that the encrypted text is completely independent of the message. This is how we formed the encrypted text. Let's just convert this vector into a density matrix. We know how to do this, and what we get is just x applied to the density matrix M. Remember that if we are Eve, we know nothing about the key. This means we are faced with a process that with some probability, and with probability half, the key is 0, generates the matrix M. And with probability half, the key is 1, generates the matrix X applied to M. So here, with a probability half, the density matrix is M, and with probability half, the density matrix is S, X applied to M. If we average these two things, we get the following density matrix. Half M plus half X M. If I plug in here the elements of the standard basis, we can see that no matter what M is, whether it's 1 or 0 to begin with, we just have half times 0 plus half times 1. And this is precisely half times the identity matrix. The maximally mixed state. You can see that we get the maximally mixed state completely independently of what the message is. And it is clear that Eve cannot gain any information from something that is independent of the message. If you think about the block sphere representation, there's actually a very nice geometrical picture of this. Namely, if I draw the elements 0 and 1 in the xz plane, then if we average these two points, we end up exactly at the origin at the maximally mixed state. So we've seen that for the classical one-time path, we can use it to encrypt a qubit in the standard basis. So does the same procedure also work for other qubits? Let's consider what happens if we apply the bit flip operator X to the plus state. We know that the plus state is the equal superposition between 0 and 1. So if I apply X to that, I get X applied to 0, X applied to 1, which just flips these two elements around. And I again get the plus state. Here, nothing happened. In fact, we can also apply X to the minus. And if you do this, you will see that we just get the same state up to a global phase. We've basically retained the information about our message. So X is not enough to encrypt in another basis. Of course, if you're familiar with quantum information, you may know, or otherwise you may have seen in week 0, that Z is the bit flip operation in the Hadamard basis. Z takes plus to minus and minus to plus. We could thus use Z to encrypt in the Hadamard basis. But note that Z is not good for the standard basis. We cannot use Z to encrypt the elements of the standard basis, because in this case we have Z applied to 0, we remain 0, and Z applied to 1, we just get minus 1. So if you compute the density matrix of this, I encourage you to do that, you will find that the state, the density matrix, retains all information about the initial state. So we have to do more than apply either X or Z. The idea of the quantum one-time pad is now very simple. Namely, instead of applying either X or Z, we will apply both of them. Z is good to encrypt the Hadamard basis, X is good to encrypt the standard basis. And we will see that both of them together are sufficient to encrypt an arbitrary qubit. Of course, because we now potentially apply two operators, we will need two bits of classical key. Two bits to encrypt just one qubit. So what this looks like is that to our message M, or in general, to our quantum state Psi, we will apply Z and X depending on the qubits. Let's first check that the scheme is correct. In other words, Bob can recover the qubit. Unlike Eve, Bob knows the key, of course. And hence, he can simply apply the inverse of the operation that Alice performed. So if I write out E, we have the inverse. Remember that X is both Hermitian and unitary. This here gives me the identity. And these two together also gives me the identity, which means that we recover M. Let's now see that the scheme is also secure. In other words, the state rho that Eve sees is independent of the qubit. I will give here a visual proof, assuming, to draw more easily, that the qubit is in the XZ plane. In the lecture notes, you can find the fully general argument. We will use two bits of key. So if I start with a qubit, for example this one, Psi, if the key bits are 0, I do nothing. If I'm in the case where the first key bit is 1 and the second one is 0, what I do is I will apply X to my qubit. Ending down here. If I'm in the case where the first one is 0 and the second one is 1, I will apply Z to my qubit, ending over here. If I do both of them, I first flip around the Z axis and then around the X axis, you can check that we will end up down here. K1, K2 is 1, 1. Now if I average out all of these four points, we arrive exactly in the middle. And you can convince yourself that this is the case no matter where I started with. With a C, that the density matrix rho that Eve sees, so Eve sees the state averaged over the bits k, is just the maximally mixed state, independent of psi. Again, we see that the quantum one-time path using this encryption has the property that independently of the initial qubit, the state that Eve has is maximally mixed and she cannot gain any information about psi. So we've now seen your first application of quantum cryptography, namely the quantum one-time path.